Welcome to the DL Gaming Podcast. I'm Bobby.
I'm Amanda.
And I'm feeling lonely. That's it. That's all three of us. Nick is at a bachelor party in Austin? Is he going to Austin twice? Anyway, he's in Texas somewhere. For sure, he's at a Cowboys game, so good on him. Sniper is somewhere watching that game at a bar. Too busy to be here, apparently. And JP Diddy said he was going to sit in, but I guess he's got more important things to do. So, yeah, feeling super special today. And nobody wanted to come to my party.
Mm. We should have more listeners on the show like we used to. Just pop in.
The call-in thing?
Yeah, the call-ins were fun.
Yeah. Yeah. Makes you feel
I'd love to see it again.
Stern.
All right. Well, it's been a busy week for me, so unfortunately I'm not going to be able to offer too much, but it looks like Emilio's got quite a bit on the radar to talk about here.
Yeah, I didn't play any video games either this week, so most of my stuff is front-loaded on the radar, and then just a couple little things on highlights.
Wow. And all right, get excited, folks. We got a great episode coming.
Jeez, the energy's lit here.
Come on, guys.
We'll pull it through. Yeah. Daze has a regular setup right there. She's got all kinds of fun stuff in store for you guys. Mm-hmm. Stay tuned.
Right, I played messages. Only video games this weekend, just one. So
nice.
According to Discord, it was like, oh, I don't want to bother her because she's obviously entrenched.
I wouldn't have responded.
Yeah. All right. Cool. Let's get right into it. On the radar is things that have come to our attention, but we have not played yet. So Mr. F and Sweet put this on the radar segment of our Discord. You can too, by the way. And I'm going to start shouting out people's stuff that I use. So basically, all you have to do is see something that you like that's going to be coming down the pike and post it there. And the second thing that has to happen is I have to like it enough to put it on here, which, you know, I try to give everything a fair shake. But this is kind of like this is Rogue Genesia.
Genesia? Geonosis?
Yeah, something like that. It's Genesia. A vampire survivor clone. It's the of all the clones, which there's 20, 30 of them now, I think, this one by far has the best graphics. It almost looks like Octopath Traveler or something, where like it's 2.5D. You've got this like pixelated character, but there's definitely depth there. And it also does this really interesting thing with focus, where like the ground is a little bit unfocused and you're focused. But yeah, I played the demo of it, and yeah, it was really fun. The gems that you pick up when you're playing, the sound was good, the music was good, and then the gem, it's just like Vampire Survivor. So you're picking up the gems, and those are XP, and it keeps you moving while you're going around. You can't just stay in one place. And you can. There's an audio tune which every time you pick up a XP token, which is a lot, but it's not annoying. But it kind of feels up like you're kind of like drops in a bucket, like doop 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 doop. And then when it gets to the top, that's when you level. So you have this like audio cue to your XP level. Like, you know, you don't even have to look at your XP bar. You know by the sound that the gems are making when. And I thought that was really fun. A cool direction to do. It's not quite as flashy as Vampire Survivors, like spells and stuff. Like, that shit gets super crazy. I can't say too much. You know, I played one level, and so I can't really talk on the depth. I did like everything that I played. It seems like a natural progression. You know, obviously, you have something that's already working, so you just pretty it up. And, on the demo, there's one of three modes you can play, so I don't know what the other modes are. If anything, it kind of looks like it lacks a little depth, but again, based on a demo, I don't know. Another thing that's different is you don't have to survive for like 30 minutes to win a level. Now it's like you kind of have this Slay the Spire kind of branching map, and every level could be like, kill 100 enemies or kill the elite would be, and then you just move on to the next one.
Hmm. That's kind of nice, because one of the less likable things about Vampire Survivor was that if you had a good run, you were going to be there for 30 minutes.
Mm-hmm. And not just that, dude, but like, I felt like the attack patterns were, I think they're always the same. I think they just come always, or very similar anyway, in Vampire Survivor. You know what I mean? And here, it's very repetitive. Like, you're playing the same bad guys in the same order every time you play the level. And then on this one, it's like, it's different every single time. So,
Well, they had different levels in Vampire Survivor. I don't know how far you made it in it, but you progressed to different levels.
No, I know. But every time you play the same level, that level is exactly the same, is what I'm saying. But yeah, this one mixes it up quite a bit. I think I saw new mobs consistently. It was good. I can recommend it. It all depends on how much this costs. These games are like notorious for being cheap, usually $3. But I can see, because of the graphics, I can see this going up to like maybe $5 or $6. I would support it at that price point too.
Well, we'll find out on the 19th when it comes out.
Yep, September 19th.
Until then, you can play the demo.
It looks like an interesting kind of world. Did you, while you were exploring that world, did you happen to find any, like, Bloody Hell hotel?
There was no hotels. You just have to sleep and shit in the fields. Bloody Hell Hotel is this the VR one, Bobby? Yeah, I think it's VR. You're a vampire that woke up after being in a coma or something, and you woke up and your estate is like gone. There's no, it's just an empty house. And so in order to get money flowing in again, you make a hotel out of your place. You have to pretty up the place, and, there's no money, right? You have no money. So there's mines underneath the house, and you go and there's actually combat in there, and you get a little bit of money, and then you invest it into your house, and you bring in people. I didn't see anything about you like killing anybody in there. I'm sure that's part of it. Oh, there it is. It looks like you do kill some of the people to stay alive. But yeah, it seems like there's all kinds of stuff to do here. There's crafting, there's mining, there's combat. There's fixing up the place, and then there's the economy of bringing in the patrons. And I don't think I've seen a VR game that has this many different things for you to do. You know what
yeah,
I mean?
Not VR.
Yeah, not in
That's
VR.
That's fascinating.
Yeah, it seems like a first person
like a sim game.
Jeez, I don't know. Almost like, what's that loot one, Bobby, that you played it where you have a shopkeeper, you're a shopkeeper, and then you go into the mines during the night, and it was a roguelike?
Moon. There were a few.
Moonlighter?
Moonlighter?
Yeah.
Moon, right?
Harvest Moon?
No, I think you're right. I think it was Moonlighter.
To moonlight means to have a second job at night. So I think it was probably Moonlighter. But anyway, that's what it kind of reminded me. So anyway. I'm like, I'm going to get exhausted playing this game. Like, I already have a job, man. But maybe for the right person, that'll be good.
Yeah, that's a lot of management.
A lot of management. A lot of shit going on, man.
Yeah, you don't really see VR games like that.
Yeah, you don't.
Although, there's not a lot of information on this game, so we don't know if you have to have VR, but I assume you do, just based on everything that we're seeing in the screenshots and videos. That game was Moonlighter, by the way.
Yeah.
But yeah,
really
that's a genre.
One, by the way, right?
I did. I enjoyed that a lot. I played it all the way through. And when I got to the end, I was like, this is the last time I'll ever play this game. I pretty much 100%ed it and like was completely over it. It was a weird experience. But that's a whole genre of games that have existed for a while, the whole shopkeeper thing.
Yeah, there's this one that keeps popping up, and I've been wanting to talk about it. It's called like the Potion Smith or something like that, or like you're the potions shopkeeper. You know, and you're doing alchemy and chemistry while the
is that a VR game?
No, that one's
no.
Actually,
I saw that one.
There was
Potion
like a
Maker.
Really old VR
Potion
game.
Maker. Okay. Actually, there's no graphics, right, Daze? Isn't it just like only?
It's just it almost looks like a book. It's like as if you're filling out a. It wouldn't be a bestiary. It wouldn't be a bestiary or whatever we were talking about. It'd be like where you're like writing down all of the different herbs in like a cookbook. It's a recipe book essentially, but for potions. And like that's how the whole game looks too.
Yeah.
Potion Craft Alchemist.
Yeah, exactly. Potion Craft Alchemist Simulator. So yeah, it looks
we got there.
Somehow we stumbled our way through. It looks like old drawings from, you know, I don't know, the 15th century or something. And
I like that.
Yeah. And you're actually doing the mixing and everything, trying to make more potent chemicals for the Witcher looking dude that comes
15
in.
Bucks. That could be good.
Yeah, it could be good. What are the reviews, Bobby?
Well, there's a lot of them.
Yeah.
11,000. 93%. That
I remember playing a bit of a demo of it, but I think I was like too stoned and then like read it and was just like, it's too much. Got off, but it looked beautiful and awesome.
Yeah.
I thought it was on, I might be wrong, but I could have sworn it was on Xbox Game Pass, or it either used to be or it is now.
So Bloody Hell Hotel is not Moonlighter or Potion Craft Simulator, but it reminded us of those. What do you got, Daze?
Nice. Well, I was going to say, you know, it's amazing the depths of the internet and all the different things that come out of it, right? And something similar to that is the game that I put on my radar, which is Paper Beasts. It is like an exploration game on VR where you are... It almost reminds me of like No Man's Sky, but all the creatures that you're learning about and all the beasts that you're learning about apparently come from different holes of the internet, and you're trying to figure out where and jump to different spots. It seemed pretty neat, and so like I wanted to check. It seemed like it would be really beautiful and immersive experience because all the creatures kind of look like origami fragments of stuff.
Yeah,
which I think is really cool. So like visually, I can imagine that being such a mind fuck. When you're playing it in VR.
How interesting. It looks like you can zoom in and out from the landscape too. So maybe you have like a god mode.
Yeah.
Daze, speaking of No Man's Sky, have you ever played it in VR?
Like it. It's too much.
What's that? What?
it's too good. Like part of the thing I really don't like about, and it's just really that there's quite a learning curve. Like I felt like there was somewhat of a steep, not super steep, like some games out there, like the game I'm going to talk about that I did play, but the learning curve for No Man's Sky still was at least steep when I played it. And then VR is like redoing everything, like relearning everything, because all of your movements are different. You got to do like basically sign language to the, you know, ship to get it to move. Like, I don't know the motions. So. But it is amazing, like in terms of the immersiveness though, because wow, yeah, like it's just incredible. So I feel like once you really know what you're doing in VR No Man's Sky, it's fantastic. But I don't know, I feel like it's a little too like not intuitive. Yeah. That it's awkward trying to play it in VR.
It's hard, you know, for in a game it's that hard. You could do so many things. It's, you know, and you don't have a keyboard. You can't type in what you want to do in virtual space. So yeah, they basically had to do a bunch of sign language for you to like interact and do all the, there's so many things, you know, and bring
which
up
makes
menus.
Sense, but it makes sense, that's a lot,
yeah,
of
how do you do it? Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know what these remind me of? These Paper Beasts. Do you guys remember like 10 years ago, 15 years ago, there was a guy who's making giant wooden and paper beasts that would walk down the beach. You guys remember this? It is the craziest shit about ever. So these things are like, well, it depends on which one, but they could be like 15 feet tall and like 20 feet wide. And they have these little sails and the sails turn. And this guy he's a mad scientist. And it makes this creature walk down the beach, and it can walk for miles as long as there's a slight breeze is enough to make this whole machine work. Anyway, crazy.
So crazy.
Look it up if you have never seen those before. It's definitely worth a shot.
Could you imagine if you were like high looking on that dude, or looking at that, or riding that thing? It'd be like, you'd be like high on life, man, which is the game that you also put on your On the Radar. I love that. I'm excited for that game too.
You are. You've taken a look at it?
Yeah.
So this is by...
Oh, yeah, because it's Justin Roiland, right?
Justin Roiland. And this is most of his games, if I remember, mostly are VR, right? Like,
yeah,
right.
It's been a lot of them, yeah.
Yeah, this one looks like his first, like, it looks like AAA graphics to me. It's a first-person shooter, non-VR, and you. I think the big selling point here, or the funny thing is all the guns you use are have personalities, and you could talk. They talk to you the entire time you're using them, and so you know, obviously they shoot differently. And they have different personalities and different voices. So they're probably just cracking wise the whole time you're going through your adventure. I did see a couple of them where it's funny because, like, that one right there, that one is like, he has a real gruff voice like this, but you're shooting his babies out of his butt. He's like, don't worry, though, I can make a lot more. So there's, like, you shoot these baby versions of him out, and those are the bullets. But, yeah. You know, we already know his comedy. We know that it's great. And I like the banter throughout, you know, that's why I like Borderlands so much. It's like the banter never stops. So if my gun's talking to me, fuck it. Whatever. I'm going to love it, I think. This looks so good, man.
I feel like I'm going to love this too. It's hilarious. I mean, to me, everything that he's pumped out has just been fantastic. I love Trover Saves the Universe. Like, and I'm blanking on some of his other games, but they are, like, all funny. I love his type of humor. And yeah, I'm very excited for this game. As soon as I saw it and I saw that the guns are talking and they're like, your guns are your NPCs. It's genius. I think it's great.
Did you finish Trover, Dave?
I think I got 3/4 of the way through. Gotcha. I got pretty far.
I've never played it. I really need to play it.
You should. It's really good. It really, really is. And it's just, once again, like the fourth wall breaking. And I think the comedy of Justin Roiland and what's his face? mostly Justin Roiland, though. Like, I love it. I think he's fucking hilarious. And so, like, yeah, all of the stuff that he makes has been so funny to me. I think you'll really love Trover. Because, yeah, if you like Rick and Morty and Solar Opposites, like, these games are so great.
And then, so, Bloody Hell Hotel and On December were both because of Burn Division. So thank you for posting that, man. So
on December,
let's have Bobby click on it so I can remember what it is. Oh, it's a hack and slash Diablo-esque game. I remember now. So I watched some of the video, read some of the stuff on this. What they're saying is it's very fast paced. I was watching the video, kind of like Souls-like. You know, everybody says they have Souls-like type stuff. You can dodge out of the way of things. I've seen an action RPG. I've played in Wolfen, I think.
Yeah.
Was almost exactly like this game. But I had no problem. Other than the bugs in Wolfen, I think I'm saying it wrong. Besides the bugs in that game, the game was great. So if somebody could pull that same thing off without the bugs, you know, I played it all the way through, and when does that ever happen? The thing that they're saying here is that they have a crazy skill tree, and you're supposed to be building yourself up to godlike status by mixing abilities to your liking. So I don't think that you're hardwired into a class. There's like a really big skill tree. And you get different things and kind of build your class as you want. And there, according to the way they made it sound, there's no limitations on what direction you can go. So I've always liked that. And I like action RPGs. And this is fast-paced. So looks great. Cool name, too. On December. Seems like, like anti-Santa. but, yeah. 2022. So... only have a few months left there to deliver. Guys, hurry up.
All right. No price yet. Also, it said that High on Life was coming out December of 2022.
Yep. Christmas time.
Nice.
Nice.
All right. Well, I guess that's it for On the Radar. Let's get to the highlights here. But first, let's talk. Did everybody hear about this EVGA news?
Yeah, so yeah. I saw a little bit about it. I watched a couple videos, actually. It's a weird thing for a company to do. So what EVGA does primarily is they take NVIDIA cards and then, or making video cards with their architecture, and then, you know, improve on them. And they're the aftermarket brand for NVIDIA. And
which a lot of companies do.
Yeah, a lot of companies does. But wouldn't you say this is like one of the premier ones, Bobby, if not the?
Yeah, I mean, I always bought EVGA
I always buy EVGA too. And
they've been doing this for years too, like decades. Over a decade, right?
Yeah, decades. And 1999, yeah. I guess they were founded. And they just got so sick of the way that NVIDIA does business that they said, we're not even going to make graphics cards anymore. We're going to pivot and start doing other stuff.
Well, they already do make other things.
Yeah.
Motherboards, power supplies.
But it makes up what NVIDIA, the NVIDIA part of their business is 80% of their business. And they're just like, nope, not going to do it anymore. It's crazy. They're doing, they're claiming also that they're not planning any layoffs, and that, you know, they're going to try to take care of their people and everything. But seems like a pipe dream to me, because you got to have the money come. 80% of your revenue's gone. I mean, you can.
Who pissed in their lunch, dude? Yeah.
Yeah. But, you know, they posted like some of the things that NVIDIA has, the way that they treat their partners. And, you know, they act like you need us more than we need you, which is probably true. But to be treated like that for year after year after your complaints, years. Apparently, they wouldn't even give you the MSRP until the day it dropped. And how are you supposed to fucking plan? How do you plan anything if you don't even know how much money you're going to be bringing in on these cards? And then the other thing is, they always put out the Founder Edition, which is a cheaper version. So you're paying for the rights to use this card and sell it at a certain price, and you have to sell it at the MSRP or above, but not below. And then they kneecap you by putting out their own card that you can buy straight from the manufacturer. So it's like, you know, it's counterintuitive. It's not good business. Well, it's been working for years, but these guys are sick of it. I'm not on either side of this fence. Like, I'm not there. I don't work there. But it does seem like for somebody to get this fed up, it must have been a semi-abusive business relationship. You know what I mean?
For a long time, yeah, and just runs them down. I mean, it sounds like they got really burnt out.
Yeah. Yeah,
and burnout's totally bad. I mean, you know, all right, hold on. We're gonna switch gears. Are you feeling burnt out? Do you feel sad? Sometimes, like, you can't get all your achievements like you want to on your video game. You're just trying to complete your Steam and you can't. Well, if you're burnt out, Guardians MH can help you out. It's something I put on my highlights. What it is it's a group of mental health awareness for the gaming community. And
this is going to show you your level.
All right.
That was a YouTube video.
No, it's like these programs. It's a 501c3 nonprofit organization that promotes mental health awareness and resources, but specifically for the gaming community. They cater as well to a lot of veterans. And so I put their website on the show notes, and they have all kinds of different things. One of the things that I think is really cool that they do is they have these kits where they will send you things. They have a Destiny 2 one that's kind of their biggest one, I think, is a Destiny 2 mental health kit. And it's just different things, but it's like a packet of stuff. And I think it does come with a Destiny 2 things in it. I know that at the moment, though, they're on back order because there's a lot of people trying to get them. But there's a ton of things online that you can do at home if you're interested. So I don't know, maybe some people are feeling that, especially if they are feeling burnt out. We had a pandemic and work is always exhausting and life can be exhausting, and so there's lots of things out there to help, and I think all of us kind of can relate to that, since we, you know, video games have always been such a fun and awesome escape for some, or at least a great distraction, you know, from stress and stuff of life. And so it's nice that they have things out here, though. They have ones catered towards Twitch streamers and all kinds of things. So yeah,
I can only support this. This is good. You know, there's people out there that, you know, they're feeling alone or whatever, and they just happen to, you know, they play games or whatever, and they would there are people out there that would have never looked for help in other avenues, but if this is already in the circle that they run in already, they they're that much more likely to click on it. So I can only support this, you know?
Absolutely.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's good. I like it.
All right. GuardiansMH.org. That's the website.
Very quick on one more thing. In construction, they talk every year we have like Suicide Awareness Week. Construction is number two most likely for suicides industries. I don't know what number one is, but I'm like, fuck, no wonder we have this every year. It's crazy. And then
I remember seeing it was a dentist. Dentist is pretty high up there. I know that.
Really? Mm-hmm. Yeah, you got to see fucked up teeth all the time. I guess so. Smell bad breath. I don't know.
What? No, I think cops are pretty high up there, or I don't know. But construction workers, I figure it's because they're already up on those big high buildings. I mean, it's pretty easy. You just jump right off, right?
Maybe.
Making jokes about mental health and suicide, folks. That's why you tune in every week.
So, yeah, I looked it up, though. I don't know what list you're getting, Emilio, but a quick Google search. It goes doctors, dentists, police officers, vets.
Doctors, dentists, police officers.
And those are professions that if you don't kill yourself, those jobs will probably kill you eventually anyway.
Yeah, especially at the beginning.
Like, fucking doctors are just, I can't imagine, like, this, everything you have to go to, first of all, to become a doctor, and then all the stress of being a doctor. And it's like, yeah, you get paid a lot, but it's stressful. A ton of student debt, first of all. And plus, you run a real high risk of getting sued. Like, it's, you make a lot of money, but you have to spend a lot of money. And it's like constant fees and shit. It's tough. I would never want to be a doctor or a dentist or a police officer.
I think it's just a really high emotional toll. But, you know, if anybody out there is listening and struggling or something, you know, there are definitely a lot of resources out there to help with people. And like I said, I think a lot of us do genuinely understand that and know that being a part of the gaming community, though, because it is another like great community, right? Just like our community on Discord. And if you want to join, which you should, and you can talk to all of us about all of this stuff or whatever, you can go to dlgaming.net and our Discord is on that website.
It's that easy. Two clicks or one type and one click. That's it.
One type, two clicks.
The keyboard has to be involved.
Yes.
Quick shout out to The Drill Bit subscribing for 16 months.
Thanks, man.
Appreciate it, dude.
Good shit.
Mid-month sub. Yeah, usually we get them at the beginning of the month. All right. So I played some Deep Rock this week. It's part of my secret plan to get a bunch of people that I'm playing Heroes of the Storm with to start playing Deep Rock.
How'd that go?
They'd never heard of it. They're just like, Deep, what's that? I'm like, oh, boy, well, let me tell you. but I'm trying the soft sale.
That's what I was going to say, Bob, because I'm always the hard sale. I fucking, hey, it's the best thing ever. You got to come over. It's the, and then they're like, it's not sucking my dick like you said it was going to suck my dick. So, yeah, mm-hmm. You're the master of the soft sale.
Yeah, so what I'm going to do is, I mean, probably sometime when I'm on their Discord or something, I'll start streaming it on the Discord just so they can check it out. And then when it's on sale, that's the time to really push it. Because $30 is, it's not a lot, honestly, for a video game, but it's a lot to ask somebody if they don't know what the game is.
Sight unseen.
Yeah, just like, hey, $30 on this game. $15, doable. Yeah. But 30, not so much.
You're in for the long con, dude.
Yeah.
It's not a con.
I'm working the long game. Yeah.
Yeah. But I did play some this week with the old Friday crew. Got together and we played a few rounds. They've got the Oktoberfest event going. And there's, I think, at the end of season two. And really, the game hasn't changed too much since the last time I was playing. It's just a lot of cosmetics. Although, I will say the Oktoberfest, one of the hats in there, it's just like a beer keg on your head. It's pretty good. So
Yeah,
there it is. Let me bring it up here on screen. Can you see it here? Oh, you can't even see it. They cut it off. You can see it there. Yeah, it's just a beer keg just sitting on your head. So that's pretty cool. And they always decorate the starting area, which is fun. And it's got like bratwurst and pretzels and all sorts of things hanging around. You know, it's nice that they do these events, but I don't think the game has changed too much. Although I will say I've got some practice to do because I'm out of, I am so like, I think it's because I've been playing Heroes of the Storm again. I'm just not, I'm having a tough time with first person shooters. When I first started playing this, I was like, whoa, this is too much. Like it didn't look right. It took me a while to adjust.
How much Heroes are you playing these days, dude?
So this is what happened with that.
that is not usually when you ask when you ask an addict how much have you been dabbling, and they ask, they're like, "Well, the story what had happened was
the story goes, yeah." Apparently, they made a change, so you play 3 placement games in ranked. I used to have to play like 10. It was so annoying. But you play 3 placement games, and now you can't place super high. Like, I used to do my 10 placements and place masters every single time. Right. Like, okay, great. Well, all the work's already done for me. Now you can no longer place higher than, I think, platinum, but it starts you off as if you were bronze, like the lowest tier. So I played 3 placement games. I lost 2 of them, and they put me in, like, bronze 2. And I'm like, dude, I am not a bronze player. Are you kidding me? What is – are you serious? And what makes Heroes of the Storm very difficult is you are as good as your worst player in that right. game. Because
almost
it's such
like a
team.
Chain, Bobby.
Yeah. Yeah, your links
like
in a chain.
Yeah, links in a chain.
Yeah, it's a team-based game. That's what I love totally. About it. But you can't hard carry like you can in other MOBAs unless, I figured out, if you play this character, Li Ming, which is the closest thing the game has to a carry. She does a whole bunch of damage, and her abilities all reset when you get a kill. So you can really build some momentum in a team fight.
Sounds like a panda?
Panda? Yeah. No. It's,
what game is that for?
Diablo. It's the mage, the game, the name that they gave to the they call him a wizard in Diablo 2, right?
Okay.
Yeah, the one that's got the laser beam that shoots out in a straight line.
But yeah, a character with the reset abilities that you know you can go for a pentakill with that.
Yeah, if you have enough mana.
Yeah.
But yeah, you can really stomp them. So what I figured out is that if I just play her all the time, I just keep winning. I am 10-1. Playing this character in ranked, and I've climbed up to silver 2 I'm at now, but it takes time, and the season ends in 2 weeks, and I do not want people to look at my profile and go back to season whatever and say, oh, this guy was silver 2 back in then.
Right.
I don't want that mark on me, so I'm trying to grind my way up, and it's, you know, it takes a while. It takes like 3, sometimes 4 wins to jump 1 level, so I'm climbing, but it's so funny because I get into a game. I don't even care what my team's doing, dude. I just insta-lock Ming like an asshole every single time. Like as soon as
because you're protecting
up,
your elo.
Yeah, I don't care what they're doing, dude. Sometimes like they get mad and they start yelling at each other and they don't pick a healer or they troll each other. I don't care, dude. I'm picking Ming. I'm doing top damage, top creep damage, and I still win, dude. 10-1. Like I'm just stomping with this character.
And it, oh, fuck, I don't even know enough to know this, but is that a scene? You go mid lane with that?
There's not a mid lane.
There's no lanes, right?
There's different maps and everything.
Yeah, oh, that's right.
There's an off lane. There's a tank and a healer. What I do like about HOTS is they do have the tank role. You don't really have that. You have supports in other MOBAs,
right.
But you don't really have tanks. But in HOTS, you have a tank, a healer, and then you have usually a bruiser as your off lane, and then 2 DPS. Like, could be a mage, could be a damage character, but I don't care. None of this matters, dude. I'm playing in such low ranks that the rules are out the window, dude.
Yeah.
It doesn't even matter. Like, I just pick this character and I do a shit ton of damage, and if we lose, it is not my fault, dude.
Do you know how many fucking sad faces you're making around the world, dude? You're steamrolling people that have no idea how to play the game.
Oh, I have idiots on my team, too, dude. They're on my team, too. It's...
I know, but I feel like you're blowing these people out.
Well, they don't even see it coming, dude.
Yeah.
Like, I got into one game, and everyone's like, let's use voice chat. And I'm like, oh, God. All right. I'll get in voice chat, but I'm not going to talk. And then they're like strategizing, and I'm just like, these guys are fucking idiots. I'm like, you know, I'm just going to pick mean guys, you know, just do what you think is best. And they did what they thought was best. And, it was disastrously terrible, but, and they apologized to me at the end of the game, man. They're just like, sorry, we let you down. I'm like,
did you win?
No.
Or was that the one you lost?
This is one of my placement games.
Oh,
yeah.
Gotcha.
Yeah, man. But it's pretty obvious when I play these games that I do not belong in there because I just kind of like crush these people, but.
Man, I have today, this week, I mean, I didn't put it on my list, but if we're talking about stuff that not on the list, yeah, I played Street Fighter this week. Not a whole lot, but it was just a bad week, man. I lost probably 9 out of my 10 matches this week. And, you know, you watch that ranking go down and you're getting frustrated. You get on tilt just like a poker player. And you're just like, I can't dig my way out of this hole. And I played casual today. I played casual. I said, okay, I got enough time for maybe 3 matches. I'm going to play casual to warm up, and then I'll get into ranked. Got stomped in casual, dude. Stomped. Stomped. But, and the guy's name was, his name was Just Some Dad. I'm just some dad too, you motherfucker. Oh man, it was so frustrating, dude.
Even match. But in a game like Street Fighter, you have no one to blame but yourself, which is harder.
Yeah.
Because it's just 1v1.
Yeah. But yes, I'm more of a piece of shit than you are, Bobby. Yes. That's exactly what's going on.
I will say, like, what I love about ranked play, I have a bit of ladder anxiety. I don't like ranked play. In Smite, I never played. I played like 3 games of ranked, won them all, and just retired undefeated.
It's so stressful.
Yeah. It's stressful because, you know, you build it up and it becomes super important. But I will say the games are so much better in ranked, so much.
Yeah.
When you play casual, in at least in MOBAs, from my experience, you get people who are just like AFK sometimes, or, you know, they just, they're goofing off, or they're just not very good.
Too casual.
You get in ranked, people are just, at least they're giving it 100%. Now, their 100% may not be that good, but at least they're giving it all.
But also, how are you ever going to get better if you're not playing better people?
Yeah, that's true.
Oh, by the way, Nick decided to try my old man energy, and I wiped the fucking floor with him. It wasn't even close.
In Street Fighter?
Yeah. And, you know, I was a little nervous because I haven't played him in probably 20 years. And he has a tattoo of Akuma and M. Bison. And I'm like, oh,
my God.
Like, what am I getting into here? And, yeah, it wasn't even close. That said, I have tons of practice recently, and he has 0. But, yeah, no. I embarrassed him.
Watch out for the rematch then.
Yeah.
Right.
All right.
We should record it next time. I'll post it up.
Well, at least you can still beat him.
Yeah, that was pretty much the only person I beat this week. Yeah, anyway. So I was reading articles, and another article that I read was how Cyberpunk is at its second all-time higher players right now. It has like 48,000 people playing at the same time at some point this week. And people are saying, well, it's obvious. It's because Netflix has a show. I didn't even know that there was a Cyberpunk show on Netflix. But it's called Cyberpunk and the Runners. I watched a couple of 2.5 episodes today. It's not arcane. It's not like fucking, oh my God, the best shit I've ever seen. But it's good because I like to see how the other citizens of Night City live their lives, you know? It's not like that they're touching on the everyman everywhere, but you see one family and one guy kind of get ripped apart and go from there. I'm not gonna give it away too much. It's a brand new show, but I'd say it's worth a shot. You know, the art isn't nothing. It's nothing to write home about.
It's anime.
Yeah, it's anime. Although, you know, at this point, sometimes it's hard to tell. Does anime mean specifically Japanese, or does it mean it could be American in Japanese style? I don't know.
It's American anime.
Yeah, I think that's what this is. But yeah,
I thought it meant animation.
It's not bad, and it's better than just like okay. I just don't want to say like everything else. I mean, it's the best thing ever. It's just maybe I'll like it more. But it's like a 4. Where were you just now? Bobby, that gave it a 4.9 out of 5.
Oh, that just, I think that was on Google. Like, I just searched it.
Yeah.
And it came up 4.9 out of 5.
Yeah. And that's 600 ratings. So people are enjoying this quite a bit. Mm. Yeah. I'll probably watch it if I have the time.
It's on Netflix.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, just showing how much more, what a turnaround Cyberpunk the game has had.
We all knew that was going to happen, though, right? Like, it was a good game. It just came out way too early. Like, they didn't have it finished.
Yeah, they said, too. They're like, we owe the... There's no way we're going to let this not just die on the vine. We owe it to everybody who bought it to make this a great game. So, makes me... It's almost complete redemption for them. But, yeah, they should have never put it out. They're publicly traded in... where are they from? Poland?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I think there's just too much pressure from...
Well, they had already postponed the game a year.
Yeah.
You know, there was a lot of pressure from all angles to get that game out.
Mm-hmm. Oh, real quick. It's something you never think, you know, the like cyberpunk universe, everybody has mods and almost everybody has like these little USB drives in their neck, you know? And then there's this girl that the main character meets, and she's not a pickpocket. She's a pick socket. She has like a tool that makes the mods pop out of their socket, and she just like grabs them out of the air and goes running. And I was just like, oh, that's so fucking cool, man. Like, of course, in this like crazy city where everybody's scraping and scrounging for every little thing, of course there'd be people just stealing mods right off of people's bodies. How crazy of a concept is that? I thought that was fantastic.
It's like new age organ harvesting.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's awesome, though. I was watching a buddy play Cyberpunk because he was getting back into it and talking a lot about both the film both the show on Netflix and also playing in like all the mods in the game now that like you can do and things like that. Like I was watching him drive a car around and just hang out the car the whole time just shooting people as he was driving by and just like going on crazy rampages with these insane souped up guns and stuff that he was able to build. And yeah, it looks like it has come such a long way because I played it when it came out, but it feels and seems to be definitely where it should have been, where it should have been when it was released. Yeah,
exactly. And there's a DLC announced now too. One thing really. When you're saying hanging out of a car and shooting, I thought of GTA. And when I thought of GTA, I can't believe I didn't put this on the show notes, but did you guys see the leaked footage from GTA 6?
No.
Yeah.
I mean, it's pretty rough. It's totally leaked. You can tell no way they wanted this to come out the way it is. But I buy it. I mean, it looks like what I think GTA 6 would look like. You know, I haven't even seen this video. So, yeah, there's like debugs and all kinds of like weird things popping up the whole time. You could tell that, yeah, somebody over there recorded some testing gameplay and put it on a thumb drive or something, like fucking some spy shit, and got it out. So you can't really tell too much, and I haven't read any analysis on the video, but I think that this is real, what people are putting out. And it doesn't look bad. I mean, not blow you away type graphics, but GTA never really did do that. You know, they were all about...
No, they just were all about the story, and then we're...
making the environments, like, realistic, or...
Yeah, I mean, it was like, I don't know, I feel like they kind of didn't invent, but cornered the market on sandboxes.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, you could run around and just shoot people out a car window, like you were saying.
Yeah, exactly.
But I don't know. They were always like so edgy, and I just wonder how, because the last one came out 2010, I want to say.
Yeah, it's been a long time.
So much has changed since then. You know, we've had our fill of like a lot of edgy games, and I don't know.
I don't think they're going to care. I don't think they're going to be PC.
No, I wouldn't think that they would switch that because of it. I just think, like, are they going to come out with a game that we've already seen 1,000 times before?
Are you saying that it's harder now to push boundaries?
Yeah, and not just, like, in that respect. Not even just, like, the political, social correctness of it all. I just mean, like, you know, the sandbox and being able to do what you want to do. I mean, think about it, dude. Like, Cyberpunk is basically like GTA, but futuristic.
Yeah. It's going to be a runaway success, no matter what.
I think so, too.
There's no, even
just at least for the RP, like just even for the RP and the online. Yeah.
Even if it's a terrible game, it's going to move millions of copies.
I don't think it'll be terrible. I think it may not be anything like amazing. But yeah, the last one just set records with the amount of copies it sold. And if it does support, if GTA 6 does support mods and all that, then yeah, there's going to be a huge community that's going to extend the lifespan of it like it did for 5. And I can't imagine they would ever get rid of that.
I would keep the game closed for the first year so everybody buys it and like with DRM and everything, and then open it up, you know. That way you have multiple waves of interest. You know, you don't just have everything all on day one.
Yeah. Or just release it unfinished and then fix it like a year later.
The ass on this chick. What's going on? Is that you? Who knows? I did like the three-character perspective from the first one.
Yeah. Wasn't GTA 6, I don't know, I'm probably misremembering something, but wasn't it supposed to have a playable female character? And people were...
That's what I thought, yeah.
Upset about that.
People were all upset about it.
I mean, you say people, but it's like five guys on Twitter or some shit, you know?
Probably, yeah.
Yeah, the vocal minority, as we tend to call them.
All right.
Days, you want to drop the ball on, or not drop the ball, but drop the hammer on what you've been doing, what you've been alluding to all show?
Yeah, so I had this entire weekend, I had all these plans for what I wanted to do. It was like, I want to go hiking and clean and do all these things, and I didn't do any of that. All I did was play Escape from Tarkov. I'm already level 8, and I've been playing for only 3 days. Which it takes for,
Are you going to work
this game
tomorrow, Dave?
I mean, I have to go to work tomorrow, but I was going to like go out and do things and go grocery shopping tomorrow. And I'm already sitting there like analyzing how far I can stretch my groceries till I have to go. Jeez. So that way I can play more tomorrow. Yeah, it's bad. It's bad. So this game, like, I feel like a lot of people listening already know what Escape from Tarkov is. It is, like, the mecca of FPS, to be honest. Like, and it's just, it's, like, survival. It has, and I knew it. Because, like, I played so much Ark and so much Rust that I was, like, I looked at Tarkov and I was, like, oh, I need to make sure I have a lot of time for this bitch. Because it's definitely, it's very complicated. You've got to be careful with the kind of ammo that you use for gun. You got to like actually pull out the magazine, then load up the magazine, then load the magazine into the gun. There's tons of bag inside of a bag of milk, inside of a bag of milk, inside of a bag of milk with this game, dude. Like, and you really can. There's condensed milk in the game. So I've definitely made sure to put one in every bag. So that way I really do have milk inside of a bag. Because that's probably the least realistic thing with the game is the fact that you can just shove like 700, like a never ending bag. Like, what was it? Hermione's fucking endless abyss spell into a purse. Like, it's like it is sometimes. But
so
I love this game.
Just continuously put containers inside of containers?
Yeah, pretty much. You can really you can just stack a whole long train of containers and bags, especially backpacks. So you can have never-ending backpacks. But truthfully, this game is very relentless. It's very difficult. It has a super steep learning curve. And I am so spoiled to have like a fantastic Tarkov community that I play with. It's like my Call of Duty friends that I play with. It's the same group, the same community, Chew for You. And there's always one or two people on, and they are way higher. They're like a pack of Bobbies, dude. It's fantastic. It's like Bobbies and Hots. It's all Bobbies. Like, and it's great. So I pop in, and they're fantastic, though. They're like, we're going to show you everything. We're going to show you a great like loot run. And every time I've played with 8 different people already where it's just me and them. And every time the style has been different, and the experience has been different, and it's been an absolute blast. Even when I'm getting my shit pushed in, it's so much fun. And honestly, the VoIP in the game is incredible. Like last night I was running around with Jew for You, and he was hammered, I was high, and we were just absolutely trolling people because I was doing a quest where I had to find beef stew. Fucking ridiculous and random. So we're running around this huge, like, abandoned mall, and every time we'd see, like, a person run up, Jew would run up to them and go, hello, and sound like try and sound like a little boy. And at one point, he ran up to this guy because I can hear him on Discord, and then in the game, I'm, like, in a different room, But on Discord, I can hear him be like, hello, do you have any beef stew? And the guy's just like, no, sorry, man. And then as soon as Jufru, you left, I ran into that room and I ran up to the guy and I was like, hello, do you have any beef stew? And he's like, the guy's like, I don't know how the hell you're doing it, but you sound exactly like the other guy that just ran up to me. And so we were just running around fucking with people, like just through voice chat and having these hilarious little interactions with people. There was one point where Jufru and I spawned and we ran up on this guy who was hiding in a bush and he's sitting there and he's like, if you're going to kill me, just fucking kill me. I have nothing on me already. And we were like, damn, he's seen some shit, and then just ran away.
like a survivor. His mind is cracked. He's just a survivor.
Yeah. Oh, which, dude, can totally happen. Like, you can be too close to gunshots that ricochet, and you'll get a tremor and, like, literally have a hard time seeing and aiming. Like, it's, the game is intense, and it's, but it is so much fun when you have, like, your friends with you and stuff, and there's just been, there's been so many amazing moments. There's, like, playing with some people, they're just kind of like, oh, here's a whole bunch of shit. Here, have this. Here, you stay here. Like, I feel like I'm, like, super babied because they'll be like, all right, you stay behind this wall, and I'm going to run out and go grab some stuff and bring it back. And I'm like, okay. And then some of the people I've been playing with, they've been like, all right, go ahead. We're just going to be standing on the other side. Go in there, and you kill everybody. Okay, bye. So, but it's been awesome because all of it's really good. And there's just, this game runs so deep. Like when we were talking earlier with Cyberpunk and there being a series on Netflix and a video game, I think it's really awesome to have these multimedia connections of community, right? And so Tarkov kind of has it too. There's some really good Tarkov lore out there. I think EUL Gaming, I want to say, on YouTube has like an entire playlist of all the lore of Tarkov, and they've produced it to feel like an actual documentary, like some Vice News documentary. And it is amazing. And it's just about the fucking video game, but the video game fired off of some like real life events that happened in the Afghanistan war. And so it's like, it's a good chunk of it is truth. And they were actually able to use a lot of real footage too. And it also still applies to Tarkov. So it's crazy. Like how deep this goes.
Is all that stuff canon? Like, do the devs agree with that?
Well, that's at least what I was seeing. Like, yeah, like it was really off of, so like Tarkov has a lot to do with there's like this Yousef group that's kind of like a militia that was bought, or mercenaries, sorry, they're mercenaries that are bought by like a chemical corporation, Terraform group or whatever. And they used to be military that came out of the Afghanistan war, and like civilian life was just too boring for them. So they started taking these high risk contract jobs and then forming like Yousef. That shit really, well, it's not Yousef, but like that shit really happened. Mm. And so, it's inspired by like a lot of that. And it's just, the story is so fascinating, but it is one of those things where it's like, when you watch it, then you're like, oh my God, now I can't wait to play. And then when you're playing and you're going through the map, you're like, oh my God, this is the lab. Like, I learned about this, you know? And it's so amazing. Like the world that how deep it goes. And yeah, RIP my fucking life for the next like, few weeks for sure. Matter of fact, I will be playing Tarkov after this.
Days. I'm just going to put you on the spot here. What is the appeal? What makes you keep coming back? Why are you having fun minute for minute or hour for hour? Because when I talk to you, you're like, oh, this is a game that's super intense for 5 minutes, and then you wait for 25 minutes.
Yeah, but that's okay. But that's because it was the very, very beginning. Like I said, this game is super overwhelming, and like the learning curve is so steep. But as you start getting better and more comfortable and understanding it better, like at first I was so so like scared and intimidated by the combat and the fighting and the shooting, because like it's intense, and you have to be pretty fucking accurate and on. You either have to go way far back and snipe people in the beginning, or you have to get lucky and be able to get up like right on top of somebody and hip fire them from like the side before they hit you, because one bullet could make you bleed out, especially depending on what gets hit. If you got hit in the chest, then you could end up like bleeding out faster. You're gonna have a hard time breathing, and you're not gonna be able to run as fast. So like all these things, like where you get hit is so important. Like if you knock out a limb, it's not that bad. But if you get like obviously headshotted, you're dead. If you get shot in the thorax, like you're going to die pretty quick. Like it's, but if you get shot in the leg, then you'll be all right. But it could be a huge inconvenience and you need like 4 or 5 different medical things and have to do them in a certain way. Cause if you break your leg, you have to like fix it with a fracture. And then if you have light bleeding, you have to use a surgical kit and then you can heal. And so it's like all these different kind of rules and things of setting it up, which I know sounds not fun at all to anybody doing a great job selling the game. But what's awesome is as you start to learn and understand it and get it, it becomes so much fun because then you're kind of like sneaking around and like looting. And then you'll hear somebody and you'll be like, oh, that's a scav, sweet. And then you like go to kill him, but somebody might come, another real player might come and like you kind of square off, and then it's incredibly fun, the fights or the interactions, because sometimes like these people won't fight you, they'll just like run up and be like chill daddy, and it's like so you have these like really funny hilarious moments, you know. But to me it kind of combines two games that I love so very much, which is Call of Duty and Ark, and because it's the whole survival aspect of it. Like I've always loved survival games. This isn't, I know that there is like crafting involved in it, but I haven't gotten to that point yet. I've mostly just been having fun, like doing these raids, which is you join in and you essentially have like 15, sometimes it's like raids are like 30 to 35 minute blocks, I think. And you can jump into a match where you either have that whole time or like 15 minutes in or something like that. They give you a 10 minute countdown once it starts getting close, and you have to get to one of multiple points. Each map is different, but they have all these different points that are called extraction points where you get, you have to run and get to that. And then you get pulled out pretty quickly. It takes, I think, like 5 seconds to get pulled out. And so you want to get in, you want to get as much shit as you can, or finish quest or kill as many people as you can and then get out. And so it's pretty fun. And there's the whole like scav and PMC, and like a scav, they have, that's the, what I was telling you where it was like, I play for like 5 minutes, die, and then I have to wait for 30 minutes. That's the scav run shit. But it's nice because it's like you start with nothing and you get to keep all of it if you actually can like extract. Which is cool. So it's just like little mini games of getting stuff. The real game is like your PNC, which is your main character. And so if you die, you lose all your shit, and it is your shit that you're like losing. So, but that could be super fun. Like the experience I had yesterday gaming with my friends and today were super different. Yesterday was all about like, let's learn the maps and go get loot and like do questing and like all the other kind of survival side of things. And then today, all we did was this map called Factory, which like, it's like the Rust map on Call of Duty. It's super tiny. So it's just like, you're constantly under action and fire and shooting people. And it was just like constant, like getting the hang of shooting and killing. And like, that's why, like, it was so much fun today having a whole bunch of people, because you're just running through and like everybody's calling out and they're like, I'm in death tunnel. And like, so we're just running through as like a unit because there was like 5 or 6 of us. And so that was really sick and a lot of fun. So for me, with these kind of games, it's always, it's the community. That's the biggest pull. It's the community for sure.
Nice. You're selling it. You're selling it. I always think about going back, but it's intimidating.
I love it. It is intimidating, and like I said, I recognize that I am probably the most privileged noob. Like, this is the best way you could go into Tarkov, which is like, you know, you're welcomed into a village of super experienced people where any one person would be like, yeah, I'll take you out, let's go have fun, like, and then show you the ways of everything, you know. But then like always be there to help. And yeah, that's a dream, you know. That's an opportunity you don't ever want to miss, right? And so with any games, but I'm very thankful to the Jew for You community for carrying me through Tarkov. But not just that, it's more of like investing, you know.
Speaking of Jew, he's in the chat and he says Harvest Moon is the best game on N64. Changed my mind. Has nothing to do with anything we're talking about. But
yeah, he posted that a long time ago. Thanks. We did talk about Harvest Moon, or we mentioned it.
Oh, we mentioned it.
Yeah.
I didn't know that game was on N64. I thought that was Super Nintendo.
Yeah, me too.
All right.
Game Boy as well.
Well, let's get to some listener questions. We've got 3 and they're all from Warconius.
Thank you, Warconius. I appreciate the
Thank you, Warconius.
Always good for the LQs here. All right, the first one, he says, any recommendations for Vegas? He'll be there next week. Is Area 15 worth checking out? And what's the best buffet?
I think Area 15 is totally worth checking
totally
out.
Worth it.
Absolutely.
Totally worth it. And what is it? Meow Wolf? Is that what it's called?
Yeah. The Omega Mart. Yeah, Meow Wolf Omega Mart.
I've never seen anything like that, man. I would definitely do that. I can't speak for all the other stuff. There's a lot of things in there.
They got a bar with some arcade games.
Yeah, but I mean the pay stuff, the other pay events. They were all closed.
Yeah, we were there late.
Yeah. I can't speak for those. But yeah.
Well, when we were in Vegas on our last DLG con, we all did some sort of VR laser tag thing or VR group. That was a lot of fun. But I don't know if you need a group for that or if you can just go by yourself and join a random group. I think you need to be with other people.
I think you go in as groups. Yeah. So I don't know who you're going with. But that was really fun.
And buffets, I have no idea. I haven't been to a Vegas buffet in forever.
My information is very old. But Caesar's was always the best in my old knowledge. Especially, but they used to have two. They had the seafood one and the non-seafood one.
Yeah, I always remember hearing about the seafood buffet at the Riviera, I think, or I don't know.
No.
It's been a long time.
You mean the Rio, probably? No?
Maybe. Started with an R.
Okay.
I don't know, man. I haven't done Vegas properly in a long time. Yeah. I'm probably too old for that.
Yeah,
so.
Once we get too old.
Yeah, I don't know. He also asks, game releases have been quiet towards the end of the year, mostly being pushed to 2023. Any releases here that you're looking forward to? And he links something that shows some of the games coming out in 2023. I took a quick peek at this. Honestly, I don't really know what's coming down the pike, but Fable, I was vaguely aware of. I really enjoyed Fable 3. It was the only Fable game I ever played, and I really got into it. Mm. So
did you finish it, Bobby?
Oh, yeah.
I don't remember this. Was this on PC? I guess it was.
Yeah, this was back... This might have been the Games for Windows Live days.
Those
dark days. I totally remember playing Fable 3. This was back in, like, 2011 that I had played it.
So there's a Fable 4 now, or is this called Fable now?
Yeah, they're just doing the whole go back to the first one. Like, I don't know if it's a remake. I think it's supposed to be like a whole new game in itself. But yeah,
looks like Wolverine's getting a game.
Yeah, Marvel's Wolverine. Apparently, there's a RoboCop game coming out called Rogue City.
Oh shit!
That'll be interesting.
Is that the name of the city? Probably in that movie.
No, it's in Detroit.
Oh, just regular Detroit.
Yeah.
Oh.
The faraway land of Detroit. So amazing. I don't know. There's not a lot of information on that. And it looks like it's not even coming out. Oh, it is coming out for PC.
Okay. Yeah.
That's June 2023. Apparently a remake of Alone in the Dark. I know that was a really popular game.
And book series, right? Is that how it started out?
Yeah, I think it was originally a book.
Yeah.
Yeah, but a lot of these other ones I was not familiar with. I thought we already had a Kerbal Space Program too.
Two, I thought so too. Either that, or just keep setting it back.
Hmm. A New Horizon game.
Yep.
Stalker 2, Heart of Chernobyl. Yeah, I don't know. Fable and the Dead Space remake. Hmm. Kind of interested in that. Yeah.
Mm.
I don't know, man. It's tough to tell because at this point, all we have is very little information to go off of. And you can't trust things in this industry.
Yeah.
Right?
We're a week by week show, man.
Like, yeah.
If it's not in front of us and you can't download it, you'd never know.
I am excited for the Modern Warfare 2 remake that's coming out next month.
Minecraft Legends.
Which I know they pump out Call of Duty all the time, but that was my favorite.
Wow. Yeah, it's cool. To get a reboot of your favorite one.
The Wolf Among Us, too.
That was your favorite Telltale game.
Yeah. But I kind of got burnt out on the entire genre.
Yeah.
I don't know. That could
it's
been
a while, though, dude. It's probably been 5 years since you played one of those.
Then Hogwarts Legacy. So this got pushed way back. There actually is some video of this out there. It looks pretty cool.
Yeah. Starfield's 2023. That's good. Yeah. Probably late 20. Probably get pushed back as well. New Dragon Age, Final Fantasy VII, the second part
called
Rebirth.
Everybody's looking forward to that, I'm sure. Yeah, there's some good stuff coming out.
for sure.
A lot of sequels, a lot of stuff that I'm sure will probably be good, but
I don't want. This is when I joined Bobby's cynicism. It's like, yeah, until it's like right around the corner, about to come out, you really can't count on this stuff.
Because everything gets delayed. It's really common in this industry. And it's also really common for a game to come out and just not be very good. You know, that Mass Effect Andromeda, you know, that one just totally tanked. So you really can't get too hyped about this stuff. And also, I don't really get too hyped about the big titles
stuff.
Anyway.
This is all AAA
stuff. I'm looking for the next, like, Vampire Survivor or something, you know, like the next weird little thing out
there. Yeah, man. It's a genre creator.
Mm-hmm.
Vampire Survivors was a genre creator.
Looking forward to milk next to a bag of milk next to a bag of milk next to.
Next one. Okay, last question from Warconius. Given your experience with playing and talking about games, do you think you could effectively consult to game studios about game design, story, or even monetization?
The key word here is effectively. I would have a ton of notes, but whether that would translate it to dollar marks, I don't know, man.
Well,
I feel like Bobby would be like, just make a good game and sell a lot of copies.
No. See, that's the problem. Like, I could not help you monetize your game. They already know how to do that. Mm. My whole thing is, like, make a great game, but nobody wants a great game. They just want, like, shit that's, like, addictive and taps into their lizard brain compulsiveness. So they fork over all their money. And, you know, it's working. They already do that.
We'd help them make less money.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I think that's it.
Yeah.
What about you, Daze? What do you think?
No, I don't. Yeah, I don't want to. I wouldn't want that pressure. And the conundrum of that, you know what I mean? Like, also, too, in a way, like, I ain't shit. Like, I'm not going to sit there and be like, I have the secrets to the best video game. Like, I don't. Although, you know, I would love for somebody to make a Tales of Nadia where you're a sailor and the storyline's super fascinating, but you're bisexual, so it's double the fun. That'd be cool. Somebody could do that. Yeah,
been
that's fascinating. Consult on that.
Somebody has a fantasy, I feel like, but
But no, I'd be terrible at consulting, I think. And yeah, same thing too. Like, the best way to make money is not always going to be the best content, right? Yeah, so
absolutely. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I was thinking about this yesterday. I was telling Sam about it. Nintendo, no DLCs. Like, How does Smash Brothers not have a DLC? Fucking Breath of the Wild does not have a DLC. We're talking some of the best games ever made, ever.
But they have new content.
They have new content, but you don't have to pay for it, ever.
And they just put it right into the game. They don't announce, like, oh, it's new.
Yeah, it's crazy. They make such quality. It's more like attuned to, like, what we would try to tell people, and they would not make money. Because Nobody else is Nintendo, man. They make fucking super solid stuff. Could you imagine just another? Could you imagine, like, a EA or somebody just putting a game out, supporting it for 3 years, 4 years, and never expecting another dime from people?
And it works at launch.
And it works. Yeah. What an interesting concept.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, they've had such a head start, and they've been going for so long. And then additionally too, like, they're not trying to do, like, crazy games. You know what I mean? Like, they're not making super extensive. I wouldn't say, like, they're not making extensive games, but, like, they're not making games that are like cyberpunk sandboxes where anything could go, like those massive open worlds that are super complex. Mm-hmm. Like, I know that Zelda is an open world, but, like, not on the level of, like, Grand Theft. I don't know. Like, I just don't think that they're making that.
They do. I don't know. I think they do kind of. They innovate a little bit. I'm thinking back to, like, Splatoon. I don't know how old that game is, but when that game came out, I'm like, oh, that's a great idea.
I don't know if that's first party. It might be.
That wasn't by Nintendo.
It might be. I'm not sure.
Yeah. Mario Paint, game changer.
Hey.
Well, I wouldn't say that that they're being innovative. I just don't think that they're being complex enough to, like, I think that because they're not being
Nintendo
overly complex, they can perfect what they have, you know?
Yeah, they stick to what they know, and it works. And I'm not complaining. I only have mad love and and respect for the way they do business.
Mm-hmm. Oh, agreed.
Yeah, me too. Yeah. I just don't really play any of their games because, yeah, they are kind of like on the simple side. Although some of them are really fun. Like Mario Party's a blast. But yeah.
Hey, simple is great. You know what I mean? Like if it ain't broke, don't fix it, right? Yeah. And so like it's definitely working for them. It's fantastic. But, you know, I'm not surprised that with the kind of games that Nintendo's pumping out that they're able to be consistent. And that is kind of better, right? Like bite off something that you can chew, digest, and like present well, right? And so like that's part of why they probably will always be such a great staple, right? Is because they stick to their motto that they have the whole time.
Mm-hmm.
All right. There it is. The DLG Consulting Incorporated.
Be Nintendo, but not.
But not quite Nintendo.
After you said something a little bit wrong there, Days, I think you said something about Jew, and I was just thinking, like, he should have a podcast that bite off what you can Jew. It'd be more than you can Jew or something like that. Yeah. He's got to have a podcast now, just based because he has a name already.
Just come by.
Yeah. All right. What's everybody playing next week?
You know what I'm playing, dude. Tarkov.
Tarkov.
God of War.
Nick will be back, so you can talk to him about that.
Perfect.
God of War, hopefully.
Okay. I have no idea what I'm going to play. My Xbox Game Pass finally lapsed that 3 months I had. I didn't play for like the last 2 months, but that was always great just to go in and see like, hey, what's new in here, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But I'll find something. Maybe I'll check out the new Sam Barlow game, Immortality.
Yeah.
Been meaning to get to that. It really depends on what kind of time I have next week. But we'll see. It's a surprise, folks.
All right. So speaking for Bobby, Days, and myself, surprise titties. Bye-bye.
Now for incredibly long outro music. Been using this one since the beginning.
But it's so good, dude.
Yeah.
If it ain't broke, don't fix it.
I'd love to find who made this and suck his dick. I mean, thank you.